Hi, I'm Don Ballance with NewTek Sales. The purpose of this videotape is to give you a demonstration of the new features of the Toaster 4.1 software and give you a complete demonstration of the Video Toaster Flyer. You can take this tape and use it as an outline to craft your own demo, or you can actually show it to customers and use it as a selling tool. You could also digitize this tape onto the flyer drives of systems that you sell so the customers can use it as a video tutorial to get them going with their new system. Just a few notes about the production itself. All of the video is recorded with the new Sony VX1000 digital camera, and the output of the Amiga is recorded to Betacam SP. Then the entire production was edited on the Video Toaster Flyer. When we first start the Video Toaster 4.1 software, it brings us to the bottom part of the screen and our project area up on the top, which starts out empty. We have a new directory utility built right into Video Toaster 4.1 software, which gives us the ability to transfer files from one directory to another right within the Toaster software. This means we don't have to have a third-party product to go out and do our file transfers. I'm now going to go to the Projects and Files view, which will show me all of the project view up here in the top. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to begin to create the project that I'm going to use for my editing session with my Video Toaster. The first thing I want to do is choose the effects that I'm going to use in my editing session and bring them into my project. There are several tabs along the bottom of the screen, which are shortcuts to get me to directories that I often use within the Toaster software. One of these is automatically set up for effects. When I click on it, it automatically takes me to my effects directory. Within the effects directory, I have folders or directories full of effects, and we leave the dissolve out. It's the most commonly used video effect. More than likely, I'm going to use a dissolve in any editing session that I use, so I'm going to go ahead and drag that up into the project area. Now, once I have an effect up in the project, medium or fast effect, or I can click on variable if the effect will let me, and type in an actual length. With some effects, you're not able to change the length of the effect, and if that's the case, the variable button will be ghosted. I'm going to make this first dissolve a slow dissolve and click continue. Now, I may want several different speeds of dissolves within my editing session, so I can take this first dissolve and clone it, go back to controls, and I can make this one a medium dissolve. I can then clone that, go back to controls, make this a fast dissolve, and so on. I now have a slow, medium, and fast dissolve. I'll choose a few other effects that I may want to use. Let's say I want to use a page peel, and possibly I'm going to want to use a soft edge wipe, and so on until I build the bank of effects that I'm going to use. I may also want to use some frame stores in my editing session. I'm going to go to the tab down here labeled NewTek, which takes me to the NewTek directory. All of the files are now installed into the NewTek directory when you install Video Toaster 4.1 and Flyer software, so I have access to everything that has to do with the Video Toaster or the Flyer in this directory. I'll now go to my frame store directory, and I will choose the frame stores that I'm going to use. Say I want to use the Flyer logo, and possibly I want to use the Video Toaster logo. I might also want some character generation in my editing session, so I'm going to go back to my NewTek directory and go into my character generator directory, or CG. Now I'm going to go into the keys directory and pull up a key. I now have effects, frame stores, and some character generation in the project, and I'm ready to start editing. I'm now going to go back to the project switcher view, and I'm ready to begin my editing session. I now have full access to the Video Toaster switcher once again, and I also have access to the luminance keyer, and I have the ability to freeze frames and save them as frame stores, just as I did in Toaster 3.1. I have my effects bank, my frame stores, and my character generation all appearing in my project now. To access a frame store, all I need to do is click on it one time, and it will automatically load into the preview bus. If I want to trigger an effect, I could click on the auto button to trigger the effect. I could manually slide the T-bar, or I can hit the space bar. I'm going to go ahead and load a second frame store in now by clicking one time on the Video Toaster logo. Now I'm going to click on the page peel. If I click on it one time, it loads the effect, and by hitting the space bar, I can trigger it. Again, effects can be triggered either by hitting the space bar, the auto key, manually triggered by dragging the space bar, or clicking on the effect a second time. So if I want to bring up a video source, I simply click on it on the preview bus. I click on the effect that I want to use and trigger that effect. I bring up the next video source on the preview bus, click on my next effect, and trigger that effect. If I want to then bring up a frame store, I simply click on that frame store. Character generation works basically the same way. If I click on it one time, it is now loaded in and ready to be keyed. I can bring this key up by hitting the space bar, and it will dissolve in for me. Hitting the space bar again will dissolve it back out. This allows me to create custom banks of effects for specific jobs. Let's say I want to create a template for doing wedding videos. I can bring all of my wedding video effects up into a project, along with whatever else I might want to use, and save that out as a project called Weddings. I could do the same thing for my corporate clients, for my training videos, or any other type of video that I'm going to be doing. Another great feature in Toaster 4.1 is the ability to sequence frame stores. Now, I can simply go to Projects and Files, find the frame stores I want to use in my sequence, I drag them up into the project area. I can now go to my effects directory and choose whatever effects I want to use and just simply put them in between the frame stores. Once I put an effect in again, I can go to Controls, set its speed. I'll use a medium dissolve. Now instead of dragging another dissolve up, I can simply clone that dissolve and then drag it over in between the next two frame stores. I'm going to clone it one more time and put one at the end, and then again and put one at the beginning. And if I fade up and fade down to nothing, I automatically fade up and fade down to black. One thing you have to be aware of is the frame stores have to be up there long enough in order to load the next frame store and trigger the effect. About 5 to 6 seconds is what I find works well. Instead of going in and having to click on a frame store, click controls, and set the length of time that the frame store is going to be up there for, there's an AREC script that comes with Toaster 4.1. And that's found in the Rex directory. Once in the Rex directory, I want to go to the Oz directory. And in the Oz directory, you're going to find something called still times. If I click on one of my frame stores and double click on this icon, it will ask me to set a duration. This will be the duration. All my frame stores are now set to 6 seconds, and I'm ready to sequence. To run this sequence, all I need to do is hit play. The toaster will process the sequence and then tell me that it's ready to play the project. When I hit OK, the project will play. This is a very useful technique if you're creating a built page with bullet lines of text that are going to appear one after another, or if you're doing some kind of montage of photography, or you're doing any kind of slideshow presentation. This is something that used to be done with third-party products. It is now done within the Toaster software itself. The other programs available in the Toaster are now accessed through the Programs pop-up menu. Hold down the left mouse button over top of the Programs pop-up menu, and it pops up revealing the programs that are available. These include Lightwave 3D, Toaster Paint, our 24-bit paint package, Toaster CG, our character generator or titler, and Chroma Effects for special effects. I'm going to go ahead into Toaster Paint and show you a few of the new features in Toaster Paint. One of the best new features is full screen display of the image that you're working on. If I load up an image into Toaster Paint now, whether I be on a 2000 or a 4000, it will load up as a full screen picture. If I'm on an Amiga 2000, it will be displayed in HAM or 4096 colors. If I'm on a 4000, it will be displayed in HAM 8 or 256,000 colors. Either way, I can now see the full image, and it's much easier to paint on the full image without having to scroll around the screen. We now also have a real-time airbrush. By clicking on airbrush, I can now paint with an airbrush tool in real-time on the screen in 24-bit. This is a handy tool for creating effects. The transwarp screen is basically the same, but slightly redesigned, with the edge and center transparency sliders being a little bit more clearly defined and easy to use. Simply hold down the left mouse button over the top and slide the slider. We now have a new palette menu, and it allows us to select colors in ways that we weren't able to do in Toaster 3.1. We have a color wheel, which allows me to move around in the color wheel to select a base color, and then a brightness control, which allows me to select the brightness of that color by sliding the slider up and down. We also create a range differently now than we did in 3.1. I simply select my first color for the range and click on Center. And then I select my second color for the range and click on Edge. I also have a Flip Range button, which allows me to flip that range quite easily. A quick tip on creating ranges: if I want to create a light blue to dark blue range, a very easy way to do that is to create my base color and then grab my brightness slider and slide it down a little bit and use that as my secondary color. This creates a very nice gradient from light to dark blue, or whatever color you might be using. We have a lot more text control now. The text function will load any PostScript Type 1 font, and these fonts are the same fonts that are available in Toaster CG. They're also usable in Lightwave 3D. I simply click on Load Font, load the font that I want to use, type in my text, and Toaster Paint will create a brush for me. I can also change the height and width of the text by using these slider controls. I can shear the text and rotate the text. I can also bold the text or create just outline of text by using these two buttons here. The options menu gives us a lot of the same functionality we had in the original Toaster Paint, just in a new layout. Here's where I can set my grid. It's also where I can copy and swap and merge my swap screens. This is where I can print my Toaster Paint screen from, and where I can clear the screen from. This is also where I have my brush control as far as copy swapping a swap brush, restoring a brush, flipping or rotating a brush. This is also where I can delete my swap screen or swap brush. Toaster Paint now also includes a process menu, which allows us to process images either individually, or it also allows us to process entire flyer clips. I'll go into this in a little bit more detail in the flyer demonstration. Now I'm going to go into Toaster CG. One of the new features in Toaster CG that I like is the ability to create a PostScript brush. This is done by going to the Controls menu and going to the plus PS Brush button. I can then type in the text that I want to use for my brush. I'll type in NewTek. I can choose what font I want to use from the fonts that are loaded into my current font book. And again, I can rotate or shear this text. When I hit Continue, that is now added as a brush from my fonts book. When I load this brush, I'm presented with the text that I typed in with a box around it. I can grab the center of this box and move it around the screen, or I can grab the lower right-hand corner, which is shaded, and if I hold down the left mouse button, I can drag this box out to the size that I want the text to be, and it will size the text in real time. This is a very handy tool, and I love it. Another new feature in Toaster CG is safety title. That's the dotted line that appears around the screen. As long as we keep our text inside that dotted line, we can be assured that it will show up on everybody's monitor. The way that we save pages in the CG has changed slightly, and I'd like to show that to you quickly. You simply go to the Control menu, and you click on Save Page. I now am presented with a requester asking me where I want to save it, and if it's a key page, I'll save it into my key directory, and I'll name it. When I name the page, it will then be represented as a crouton in the switcher screen, like I showed you before when I was sequencing CG frame stores and effects. The concept of books is still valid in the CG, although you don't use a book to bring up successive pages of CG. It's simply a way of storing a number of CG pages so that you can bring them up later and change them. Once you're back in the switcher screen, if you look at your program's pop-up menu, any program that has an asterisk next to it is currently in memory. And if you're going to go into Lightwave or Toaster Paint to do some intensive graphics work, you might want to unload any of the programs that are currently resident in memory. This can be done by holding down the Shift key highlighting that program and letting go of it. When I go back and look at the program again, I can see that the asterisk is gone. I think the functionality of the video toaster has been greatly enhanced by the new features, the ability to create my own effects banks, the ability to sequence frame stores directly from the switcher, the new features that I have in Toaster Paint and CG. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the video toaster flyer. The flyer is an add-on card to the video toaster, which allows me to digitize all of my audio and video directly to my hard drives, and then use my hard drives as my sources to the video toaster. This completes NewTek's vision of an entire video editing system in one box. It makes the editing process simple and easy to use, and because all of my images are digital, I never suffer generation loss. Let's take a look. The first thing we need to be able to do with the flyer is to get our audio and video to our hard drives. It's actually quite easy. I'm going to go to the Projects and Footage Requester. From within this requester, it asks me a few questions. What drive would I like to send my video to? On this system, I have two audio video drives, Flyer A and Flyer B, and I have a third audio drive. You need to have that third audio drive in your system if you'd like to add background music, narration, or sound effects. I'm going to record to drive A. Then it asks you what quality level you'd like to record at. There are three video quality levels within the flyer, HQ5 being the highest quality level, then standard, then extended. At HQ5, you'll get approximately 3.5 minutes per gigabyte. At standard, you get about 5 minutes per gigabyte. And in extended, you get about 7.5 to 8 minutes per gigabyte. And then we also have the audio only quality level if you're digitizing audio only. I'm going to go ahead and digitize at HQ5. These numbers tell me how much time I have available on the current drive that's selected, and how much time I have on that drive if I want to reorganize the drive. As you add and delete files from a hard drive, it fragments, just like it does on a regular computer system. As you add and delete files on your flyer drive, the reorganized time will slowly get bigger and bigger than the time that is available on the drive. To reclaim this drive space, all you need to do is click on the Reorganize button. You have to be aware, though, if you have a 9-gig drive that's full of video, this can take a long period of time, possibly up to a couple of hours. So I suggest reorganizing your drive well in advance of an editing session. Next, we select what source our video is coming in through. All of the video that's digitized onto the flyer comes in through the video toaster. The video toaster is a 4-input switcher, so I have 4 inputs to choose from, as well as main out. Main out is kind of an interesting selection because it lets me record the main output of the toaster. I would use this, say, if I wanted to record some character generation or a title directly onto a clip and make it part of the clip. I could feed the video into the toaster, key the overlay on top of the video, and record the main output of the toaster so that the title is actually part of the clip. This comes in handy when you get into tight sequencing situations within the flyer. Now I have VU meters, which bounce up and down, showing me the audio level coming into the flyer, and these sliders allow me to adjust that audio level. Right now I have a camera pointed at me coming into the flyer, so it's my voice which is causing the VU meters to bounce up and down. Once I get my audio levels set, and I have all these other questions up here answered, I'm ready to actually record my video to the hard drives. I do that by pressing the record button, and when I press the record button, it shows me the length of the clip that I've recorded right here. I can also pause and then restart the recording at any time. I'm going to record about 10 seconds worth, hit stop. Now I'm actually ready to cut clips. Now for the sake of the demonstration, let's say I actually recorded a half hour or even 45 minutes worth of video. I now want to be able to take that one big clip of video and cut it into smaller, more usable clips. We'll go to the Cut Clips menu by clicking on Cut Clips in the lower left-hand corner. The first thing that I want to do in Cut Clips is name my first clip. I do that by clicking in the Clip Name box, deleting out the name that's in there, and I'm just simply going to call this clip number 1. You want to make sure that you always hit the return key after naming a clip. If I simply hit perform, it would be called new clip 1 because I never changed the name because I never hit the return key to get out of that box and confirm it. Next, I could put a comment in such as scene 1, take 1, or whatever I want to denote that actual clip that I'm using. Now I'm ready to define clips. I can define clips by moving the endpoint and the outpoint in real time. As I slide the endpoint slider, you can see that I slide through the video in real time. So I would say, okay, I want my first endpoint to be here, and I want my first out point to be here. Now, I can click down in this gray area, and when I do, my endpoint automatically goes to where the last out point was, and I'm now ready to select my second clip, and my clip name has automatically been numbered as the second clip. I can change the base name of the clip at any time during the clip selection process, simply by going up, renaming the clip, and giving it number one again, and it will start renumbering the clips from that point for you automatically again. Let's go ahead and select my second clip. Okay, my endpoint, my out point. I again click in the gray area down here and select my third clip. Any of the video that remains in these gray areas will be lost. This is what's known as a destructive edit, and there's no way I'm going to be able to get that video back unless I actually go back and redigitize it again. Another interesting feature is that I can actually overlap my clips, making my endpoint of clip number three halfway in between clip number two, and it will create two separate clips using their own in and out points. Once I've created the clips, I can then select the icon or the picture that's going to represent that clip by moving this slider backwards and forwards and selecting the actual picture that I want to use as my icon for each individual clip. Once I've selected the icons for my clips, I can select whether I want them to be audio-video clips, just audio clips, or just video clips. Once I've done that, I'm ready to perform. When I perform, what I end up with are little croutons or pictures that represent the video clips that I've defined. If I want to look at the raw footage that I now have on my drives, all I need to do is simply double-click on a piece of footage, and it plays back for me. This will play the entire raw clip that I recorded in, and a piece of advice would be to always record a little bit more at the beginning and a little bit more at the end on your video clips to accommodate transitions. Okay, I've decided that I like that first clip and I want to use it in my project. So I simply grab it with the left mouse button, drag it, and drop it into the project area. Now I'm going to take a couple of other croutons. We'll use this one here, and we'll use this one here. Now I'm ready to look at the controls menus for the croutons themselves. I'll click on my first crouton and go to the controls menu by hitting the controls button. I can also hit the F9 key on my keyboard, which will also open up controls. Once in controls, I can again select an in and an out point by moving these sliders and previewing the video in real time. So I can select my in point. Let's say I want the ship to start about right there. Now I'm going to grab the out point slider and I'm going to select my out point, and I'm going to make this clip about 5 seconds long. Here's the length of my clip right here. I'll hit continue and do the same for the other clips. I'm going to click on the clip and hit F9 to open up the control panel. Now set endpoints and outpoints. Here's my endpoint, and here's my outpoint. Again, making the clip about 5 seconds long. Now the last clip, click on it, hit F9, grab the endpoint. We'll start it there. Now I'm going to grab the outpoint, drag it back, again, making my clip approximately 5 seconds long. I'm now ready to play this back in cuts only, and I can do that simply by hitting the play button. The flyer will process the sequence, and then it will give me a requester telling me the project is ready to play. When I hit OK, the project plays. Here's my first scene, cutting to my second scene, and then finally cutting to the third scene. Now, what would always happen to me when I was editing on a regular tape editing system is the client would say, "Yeah, Don, you know, I really like your work, except those first two scenes, can we reverse those?" Well, that's really not too bad. That's your basic video insert edit. It really hurts when they say, "Can you reverse those two scenes, first two scenes for me, and can you shorten that first one up a little bit?" At that point, I'm re-editing my entire tape because I'm going to create a little black space in between the first and the second clip. Well, let's do exactly that in the flyer. I'm going to reverse my first two clips simply by dragging the second clip in front of the first one, and then going back into controls by hitting F9 and shortening this clip up a little bit, and I'm done. I hit the play button. Again, it tells me the project's ready to play, and I can either click on OK or I can hit the return button on the keyboard. My new project plays, and I now have my first two scenes reversed and the first scene shortened up a little bit. One of the features that I like about the Flyer is I don't have to have video clips on separate drives in order to do A/B roll. In fact, I can A/B roll from within the same clip by defining different portions of that clip using the Controls menu and then putting an effect in between it. Let me show you what I mean. I'm going to go ahead and delete out this sequence that I have in here by selecting All and Delete. And this does not delete anything from the hard drive. This simply removes these croutons from my project area. I'm going to go to my other video drive, and I have a crouton here, which is a long piece of video that's already been edited and has a soundtrack. Let's just take a quick look at it. This is a series of cuts put to music, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a couple of different cuts out, arrange them in the order that I want to see them, and then play them back. Let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to hit stop, which will stop the sequence, and again I'm going to go into controls. I'm going to pick my first video clip, again by sliding my endpoint. And I'll start right about here, and then the out point about right there. I will then click continue. Now I'm going to clone this clip by clicking on the clone button, and it will give me an exact duplicate of that clip. Now I'm going to go into controls of the second clip and redefine it as a new clip. I'm going to click on controls, and if I hold down the shift key while I move the endpoint, the out point will move along with it. Controls now on the third clip and redefine my third clip. So we'll start about right there and we'll end up about right there. I'll hit continue and I'm ready to play a cuts only sequence. I hit play, the Flyer will process the sequence, and then again the project is ready to play. So I have my first clip, my second clip, and my third clip. Now all of these clips are actually from the same source clip. The interesting thing about the Flyer is I can now actually do A/B roll between these newly defined clips, all coming from the same clip from the same drive, simply by going to my effects banks. I'm just going to use a dissolve, and if I want to put a dissolve in between two pieces of video, I simply drag the dissolve up and place it between the two pieces of video. Now I can go into controls on the dissolve and set speed, slow, medium, fast, or variable. I'll just use a medium dissolve, click continue. Now I'm just going to clone the dissolve, drag the clone in between the next two clips, clone it once again, drag one to the end, and clone it one more time and drag that one back to the beginning. And again, if I fade up and fade down to nothing, I automatically fade up and fade down to black. I'll hit play to process the sequence. The Flyer does a little bit of math, and now it's ready to play. Okay, that's pretty neat, but one of the things that I notice is that the music is still jumping from clip to clip, even though I have dissolves in between the actual video clips themselves. Well, what I'm going to do is go back to my original clip, highlight it, and go back to controls by hitting F9 on the keyboard. So far I've shown you that I can set in and out points. This button here allows me to play the audio or not play the audio. I can also lock this clip down to the program time, which I'll explain a little bit more in a minute. I also have a button up here which says Fine Tune. If I go into the Fine Tune menu, I have a lot more control over the clip. I can now set individual in and out points for the video and the audio. I can control the volume. I can control the balance left to right. I can control the fade in or the fade out of the audio, whether or not the audio is going to play in stereo or in mono. And I have these buttons here that say auto. And what those will do is they will automatically create a crossfade to match the length of the transition between the two video clips. Even if I go back later and change the length of that transition, my crossfades will automatically change with the length of the transition. So I'm going to go ahead and turn auto on, and because there is no video clip in front of this one, I'm going to set a fade in of 1 second. I'll hit continue. Now I'm going to go to my second video clip, and the keyboard shortcuts for getting to fine tune are a little bit easier than clicking through the menus, I feel. I'll hit F9, which gets me to the control panel, and the help key toggles between fine tune and quick tune. Now I'm going to turn auto on both of these, and I'll go to my third clip, F9 to get to the control panel, the help key to get to fine tune, and I'm going to turn auto on for the fade in, but again, this is my last clip. It doesn't transition into another piece of video, so I'm going to do a manual fade out of 1 second. Hit continue, and hit play to process the sequence. The flyer processes the sequence, and we're ready to play it back. And I have fade ins and fade outs where I want them to be. Now that works very well, but let's say I'm still not happy with that audio track because it's still jumping around even though it is fading. Well, what I can do is I'm going to highlight all of the video clips simply by holding down the shift key and clicking on all of the video clips. That way it allows me to highlight multiple video clips at one time. Now I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to come to my tools bar. And one of my tools in my tools bar is called Audio Off. And when I click on that, the little speaker that had appeared up in the upper right-hand corner is gone. That's telling me that the audio on this clip is not going to play. The keyboard equivalent of turning audio on and off is Alt A. And if I hit Alt A, my little speakers appear again, and they're gone. I've now scrubbed the entire audio track from the sequence and it will be silent, and I'm ready to add my own audio to it. I'm going to go to my audio drive and then drag it up into the beginning of the sequence. Now, audio clips can be manipulated two ways. If I take an audio clip and I put it after a piece of video, it's going to start playing when this piece of video starts playing. But usually what I like to do if I'm using something for a soundtrack behind an entire sequence is place it in the beginning of the sequence and lock it to the program time. To do that, I'll go to the tools bar and I'll come down to lock, unlock. And a little padlock appears in the upper left-hand corner. The keyboard shortcut for that is Alt-L. And if I hit Alt-L, we can see that the padlock appears and disappears. Now that this is locked to the program time, I'm telling it to start playing at this point in time during the program, and it's not associated with any of the other clips in the sequence. So even if it was the only thing in the sequence, it would play. Next, I'm going to click on the last effect in the sequence, and right up here it will show me the current program time is 15 seconds and 17 frames. I'm now going to go back to the audio clip, go to controls, and it shows me the length right here. I'm going to trim up the beginning, which was pretty close to begin with, and now I'm going to drag the out point back, and I'm going to make it a little bit longer than what it told me it was. Now I'm going to go to fine tune, and I'm going to give it a 1 second fade out. I'll press play to process the sequence, and the project is ready to play. You can see that it faded up and faded out right where I wanted to and gave me a consistent audio track underneath my entire sequence. I can continue background narration simply by dropping audio croutons in where I want, going to controls and setting their volume levels. As long as I don't go past 8 tracks, I'm okay. Now let's say I want to add some character generation over top of one of my clips. I'm going to go to the third clip in the sequence here, go to controls, and lengthen it out, give myself a little bit of time to work with here. I'll make it about 10 seconds long. Now I'm going to go to the NewTek drawer by clicking on the NewTek tab, and I'll go into CG, and I'll go into keys. And I'll just use one of the key pages that I created earlier. I'm going to take the key page and drag it behind the video clip that I want it to occur during. Now I'm going to go to controls. Once in controls, I can establish how long I want the key to be up for. Length, let's make it 5 seconds. Start time tells me when do I want it to start. Well, usually with a key like this, you're going to want to give it a little bit of start time, a little bit of pre-roll. So I'll give it, say, 2.5 seconds. You don't always have to do that, but I just find it works best that way. Next, do I want it to fade up or fade out, or do I want it to cut in or cut out? I'd like it to fade in and fade out at a medium speed. I click continue. Now I simply hit play to process the sequence. The flyer does a little bit of math, and it's ready to play the project. My audio cut out a little bit early because I didn't lengthen it after I lengthened the third clip. If I want to go ahead and change that, I simply click on the last dissolve again. My current time is now 2011. I'm going to go back to my audio. Here's the audio length. Make it just a little bit longer. Now, instead of watching the entire sequence to see whether or not that edit just worked and my music is going to fade out where I want it to, I can simply click on this last crouton and click on the Play From button. And this will play the sequence from that point. This comes in very handy when your project becomes lengthy. I'll click on Play From, it'll process the sequence, and we're ready to play. And that worked out great. Okay, let's say I don't want to use dissolves. Let's say I want to use some of the other toaster effects. I'm simply going to go to my effects directory and pick some effects. Let's say I want to do a page peel. I can take the page peel, drag it, and simply replace one of the dissolves. The flyer will ask me if I want to overwrite this effect. I'll say okay. The little arrow button right here is my parent button, and when I click on it, it takes me one directory out back into my main effects directory. Now let's say I want a soft edge. I'll take the soft edge and plop it over this dissolve right here. I hit the play button. Again, the flyer will process the sequence, and I've been adding effects to this sequence and changing effects. And as you notice, the flyer is always ready to play the project right away. That's because everything in the flyer is done in real time. There is no rendering of effects. That is one of the main strengths of the flyer, and it really opens up your creativity and allows you to experiment with a lot of different effects, different CGs, adding different music, and getting instantaneous feedback on your experimentations. I like to say it opens up your creativity or your artistic side and lets you forget about the drudgery of editing. Let's go ahead and play this project. Okay, that worked great. I'm going to clear this sequence out. And let's say I want to do an insert edit. And this is, I've got someone on screen and they're talking about something. And now I want to go to what it is they're talking about, but I still want to hear them talking underneath it. And then I want to come back to them and have everything synced up and ready to go. You see this on the news all the time, and it's your basic video insert edit. This is very easy to do with the Flyer. Let me show you how. I've got a video clip of Kevin Bacon talking about his experiences making the movie Apollo 13.
We were riding it.
It's funny because, you know, with all the things that they can do these days, the special effects and everything, basically the launch sequence, you know, they have the capsule, and they just got a guy under there shaking it.
Okay. You know, that's... So we have Kevin talking about special effects in movies. So what I want to do is, when he starts talking about special effects, I want to go and show some special effects. And then I want to come back to Kevin and have it all be synced up with his audio underneath the whole thing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go find what I want to use as my video insert. And I'll use this clip right here. And I'm going to go to controls on that clip and shorten it up a little bit. I'm going to make it about a 3-second video insert. Now let's make it 4 seconds. There we go, 4 seconds. Now I'm going to go back to the original clip here, clone it, and drag it to the other side of my insert. Go back to the original, go to controls, and drag the out point back to where I want the video insert to occur. A really easy way of doing this is dragging the out point all the way back, and if I hold down the right arrow on my out point here, the clip will actually play through for me.
We were riding it.
It's funny because, you know, with all the things that they can do these days with special effects.
Right there when he says special effects, I want to go to the shot of special effects. So that's where I want my insert to occur. Now I simply click continue, go to my tools bar, and do an auto insert. Audio insert performed. Now what the Flyer has done is it's done a split audio edit between the first clip and the second clip, allowing the first clip's audio to run underneath the entire length of the video insert, and then it's done a match frame edit so that this clip now syncs up with the original and it all goes together seamlessly. Let's take a look. I'll hit play, it processes the sequence, and we're ready to watch.
We were riding it.
It's funny because, you know, with all the things that they can do these days, the special effects and everything, basically the launch sequence, you know, they have the capsule, and they just got a guy under there shaking it.
Okay, that worked well. Now, once I have an insert edit set up like this, I can very easily go back in and add effects. Let me take a dissolve and put it between the first two clips, clone it.
The launch sequence, you know, they have the capsule, and they just got a guy under there shaking it.
You know, that's bored.
You know, that's what was making the shaking moves.
Okay, now that I have this set up, when I come back to Kevin, I want to actually put a piece of CG over top of him describing who it is, Kevin Bacon. Go to the NewTek directory by clicking on the NewTek tab, the CG directory, the keys directory. You may notice that a lot of my CG pages are going to start to look alike, and it can get kind of confusing figuring out exactly what's what. If I hit the right Amiga key, which is the key just to the right of the space bar, it will turn my icons into their text counterparts. Now I can see Kevin is right here, and if I drag this up into the sequence and let go, it turns back into the icon automatically for me. Now, again, I simply drag my CG to the right of the crouton I want it to appear during, go to controls, and again, I want the key to stay up for 5 seconds, and I want it to start, say, 2.5 seconds into the clip, and I want it to fade in and fade out at a medium speed. Now let's play the sequence once again. I'll hit play, which processes the sequence, and we're ready to take a look at it.
We were riding it.
It's funny because, you know, with all the things that they can do these days, the special effects and everything, basically the launch sequence, you know, they have the capsule, and they just got a guy under there shaking it.
You know, that's bored.
You know, that's what was making the shaking moves, and it made this really intense rattling noise, which was great.
Yeah.
And
okay. Now let's say I want to do a little bit of Foley work, and I want to add some sound effects to some of my animations and or video. I'm going to go ahead and clear this sequence out. And let's go get a piece of video. I'm going to bring this animation up. I'm going to turn its audio off. And I'm going to go into controls, and I'm going to go ahead and lengthen it out to its full duration. And let's take a look at it. I can also play clips directly from the control panel by clicking on this play button. Let's take a look from here. So there's one explosion and there's another explosion, and those are the sound effects that I want to map in. Okay, I need to go to my audio drive and find my sound effects. I have them in a folder labeled effects. And here's one of my explosions. I double click on it to hear it. Say okay. I drag it up into the sequence and place it to the right of the crouton I want it to happen during. Now I'm going to go back to the piece of video, go to controls, and I'm going to move the out point back to where I want that sound effect to occur. So I'm going to look at the video and say, okay, the sound effect happens right there. And what I usually do on something like an explosion is go maybe the frame right before it. Now I was moving the out point slider, so I'm going to click in the out point timecode box and hit C on the keyboard. That will copy that timecode into a buffer for me. Now I'm going to hit cancel. I have not manipulated this video clip at all. I just went in and took a piece of timecode from it. Now I'm going to go to the audio clip, go to controls, and I'm going to tell it that I want it to lock to the clip's time code. Go to the start time, click in that box, and hit V, just like cut and paste in a desktop publisher, and it pastes that piece of time code in there for me. What I'm telling the audio clip here is, when the video clip reaches this time code, trigger the sound effect. Let's go ahead and watch this. Okay, there's my first explosion right where I wanted it. Now I'm going to map in the second one, and I've got a bigger explosion. Same process. I'll go to the video clip, move the out point back to where I want that explosion to occur. I want it to happen right there is probably good. I will click in the out time code and go to the start time and hit V for paste. You also want to make sure that there's no dead space in the beginning of your sound effect. Sometimes when you record sound effects, you may hit record on the flyer and then have to reach over and hit play on your CD player. There's going to be a little blank space in there. You want to make sure that they're trimmed up and ready to go. Okay, this one's trimmed up pretty well, so I'm just going to leave it the way it is. I hit continue, and let's go ahead and watch this sequence. Play to process, and we're ready to view. So I mapped my two sound effects in there pretty nicely. Again, I have 8 tracks to work with, so I can continue layering effects. I can go into the sound effects, go to controls, go to fine tune, and adjust their volume. I can pan them left to right, anything that I want as far as mixing the audio the way that I want it to be mixed. Once I have my sound effects laid in, maybe I want to lay a soundtrack down behind the whole thing. I'm going to go find some music to put behind it. Lock that music down. Go to controls and trim it up. That's good right there. And run the sequence. So now I have a soundtrack, and if I think the soundtrack is a little bit too loud, go into controls, fine tune, turn its volume down a little bit. Another nice thing about adjusting volumes on the soundtrack, if I go into controls and go to fine tune, I can actually play the soundtrack and adjust it in real time. So I can figure out exactly where I want my volume level to be, stop it, and I'm ready to go. So it's very easy to mix levels as far as sound effects, background music, narration, whatever other audio you might have. Now that I've shown you how to map your audio to your video, I can show you how you can map your video to your audio. This is by far one of the neatest things that the Flyer does, and I have a lot of fun doing it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to load up a project that I created called Music. And in this project, there's a series of animation clips, and a piece of music right in the front. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and select these and unlock them, and then lock down my audio clip. So I have a series of video clips with an audio clip that's locked down in front of the whole thing. Now I'm going to highlight the audio clip, go to my tools bar, and tell it that I want to edit to crouton. And when I do, it tells me that it's ready to edit to music. When I hit OK, the music is going to begin to play. When the music starts to play, I'm going to start hitting the space bar. Each time I hit the space bar, it's going to lock down the next consecutive clip to that as an endpoint for me. And when I'm done, it'll automatically go back and fix all the outpoints for me. And basically, we're going to make a music video right here. Let's take a look. I found it works best if you shake your head. Big finish. Okay, now I hit stop, and the flyer says, shall I fix the outpoints necessary to accommodate the croutons just edited? That'd be great. Click OK, and it automatically fixes the outpoints for me. Let's process the sequence and take a look at what we've got. Okay, that was pretty cool, and I got all my hit points exactly where I want them, but what if I'm not using the portion of the video clip that I want to use? Let's say I'm trying to do a lip sync or a guitar sync or something like that. I can very easily go back to any crouton, click on controls, and if I hold down the shift key while I move the endpoint, the outpoint moves with it. So now I can say, well, I wanted this one to start out up here, and this one here, I'm going to go to controls, and I wanted this one to start back here, and so on and so forth, allowing me to pick exactly the piece of video that I wanted to see, and my hit points are still exactly where I want them to be, right to the beat of the music. Once I get all my hit points locked down and I get the video portions playing the way that I want them to play, as long as I have enough video to accommodate the transitions, I can go back and I can add transitions in between these, and it wouldn't disrupt the sequence at all. All the animations that I used in this demonstration were created with Lightwave 3D. Lightwave is NewTek's 3D animation and modeling package used extensively in television and Hollywood. Hollywood professionals can use any package they want, and a lot of them are turning to Lightwave 3D. Why? I believe it's because Lightwave is an inexpensive package, costing 3 to 4 times less than a competitor that does the same thing that Lightwave does. Its learning curve is also very low, which makes its productivity very high, and its output is phenomenal, as good as, if not better than, most of the other packages on the market. The marriage between the Flyer and Lightwave is a beautiful one, because I can render my Lightwave animations directly to my Flyer drives and then play them back. I don't have to have a single frame recorder, and I don't have to have any kind of digital MPEG compressor. I can also use any Flyer clip as an image sequence in Lightwave. Let's say I want to make a fish tank. I can make a box, and then I can put legs on the box. Now I want to have fish and water and bubbles and seaweed. Well, I may not be good enough to do that in Lightwave, but I am good enough to go home, point my video camera at my fish tank, digitize that into the Flyer, and then map that onto the front of the box. That way, when the animation camera looks at the box, it sees fish and water and bubbles, and they look real because they are real. Anyone can do this technique, and it gives you very photorealistic results. The Flyer has a lot of third-party support available, such as products like Flight Gear and Radar, Control Tower, Copilot, and many, many more. All of these products add a large amount of functionality to the Flyer, such as timeline interfaces, audio control, and the ability to take flyer clips out to image processing packages, process them, and bring them back as new flyer clips. Please consult your dealer on third-party packages. There are a variety of them available, and most of them are very, very good. I hope this tape has been a good help to you. And if you have any questions, please consult your dealer or feel free to call NewTek. Thank you for your time.